Alrighty, well, good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to True Grace Bible Ministry. Once again, my name is Mike Marcheski, and thank you for being with us. And I count it a privilege to be able to teach God's Word, rightly divide it. Well, before we get into our study this morning, I'd like to take this time and thank all our veterans who served in all branches of our military, including those non-Marines. But for us Marines especially, I reach out and wish you a little belated birthday. Marine Corps birthday is also November 11th, so I wish my fellow brothers and sisters a happy birthday. All right. Do you know, if it wasn't for our military, I may not be here preaching today and teaching today. Because we wouldn't have the freedom to do what we do. So if you see a veteran out there today or in your near future, thank them. Yes, we have freedom in Christ, but because of the freedom in this country, it's because of our servicemen and women. So thank them. Alrighty, let's get into our study now. We've been discussing the circumcision and the uncircumcision, how James, Peter, and John had that handshake of fellowship with Paul and Barnabas, and that Paul and Barnabas would go to the heathen, and James, Peter, and John to the circumcision. And it seems like that has caused much confusion, because some want to teach, as I'm talking, let's go to Galatians chapter 2, that these are basically, you know, two different groups of people, okay? That the circumcision that James, Peter, and John are going to, and the uncircumcision that Paul and Barnabas are going to, are just separate people, but they're preaching the same message. Well, that's not so. They're two different messages. One's the gospel of the circumcision, one's the gospel of the uncircumcision. And that's what we looked at last week. Both being the foundation of Abraham. We looked in Genesis 15 that Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And then we seen in Genesis 22 where Abraham took his son Isaac, okay? He put his faith into action, didn't he? And then we looked at a verse in Romans, chapter 3, verse 30, how that God would justify the circumcision by faith and the uncircumcision through faith. See, through faith is faith alone. By faith is what God was telling him to do. And in time past, it was faith, but they had a prove that faith by their works. And then again, that's what James is speaking of, okay? So that's what we looked at last week. All right, that Abraham, yes, is the foundation of both. Now, let's read here in Galatians. And remember, we've discussed this before, that Galatians chapter 2 coincides with that Jerusalem council in Acts chapter 15. And the one of the main contentions was that the Judaizers wanted these Gentiles to get circumcision and keep the law. Okay, that was one of the big contentions. Here we even see in Genesis that when, in Galatians, when Paul took Titus with him, you know, they wanted Titus to get circumcised. Okay? But he knew he didn't need it. Alright? So, again, there were two different messages being preached by James, Peter, and John, and Paul and Barnabas. That is the foundation. They did not preach the same message. And, you know, this one body truth that all are in the same body today, that those kingdom saints were translated or transformed into the church, the body of Christ. Can I believe that's a false teaching? We're going to be looking into more of that as well, okay, to prove that what these guys are teaching is, again, speak the truth in love, but they're wrong, okay? So, and it does make a difference, okay? I don't want to get sidetracked here about the one body truth thing, because we want to stick on the circumcision and the heathen today. But it does make a difference. Okay, it really does. Because if James, Peter, and John were part of the church body of Christ, then the epistles they write, as we're going to look at here in a bit, how do we apply them to us? You know, if we're all one in Christ. But that's another day. But for today, we're going to look at and answer this question. Is Israel today, that nation in the Middle East, are they there in circumcision or uncircumcision? That's the question we want to answer today, okay? Israel today, are they there in circumcision or uncircumcision? And if they're there in circumcision, then I think it would be safe to say that God's still dealing with nations. They're still under the law. And if they're dealing, if God's dealing with them in uncircumcision, when did they become uncircumcised as a nation? And when did they fit into the uncircumcision, if I may? Okay? All right. So, Galatians chapter 2, verse 6. It says, "But of these who seem to be somewhat, whatsoever they were, it maketh no matter to me. God accepted no man's person. For they who seem to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me. But contrariwise, on the other hand, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter." Doesn't that right there show distinctive differences? They're not the same. For he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they unto the circumcision. So that's what we're going to look at this morning, okay, about the heathen. Who are the heathen? And 145 times in the scriptures, the word heathen is used. And every time, it is used in association with, and of course the Old Testament was about Gentiles, okay, because God was dealing with Israel. But as of a foreign nation other than Israel or Jews and no relationship with God. That in a nutshell, okay, may be my own definition of it, but that's the definition of a heathen. That was the definition of a heathen. Okay? Those Gentile nations were heathen. They were wrapped up in idolatry, weren't they? They didn't worship God. They had no relationship with God. And it's really no different today. That's what a heathen is today. And that's what we're going to look at about this nation of Israel. Okay? So basically a heathen is an individual that has no relationship with God. Rooted in paganism, idolatry, and on and on. But I think in a nutshell, that's the simplest way to understand it. They have no relationship with God. Now, we see that the gospel of the uncircumcision, faith alone, was committed to to Barnabas and Paul. Where the gospel of the circumcision, faith plus works, was James, Peter, and John. All right. Before we get into all that, I briefly want to go back and look at our board here and just refresh ourselves of what's going on in the book of Acts. Remember, Galatians chapter 2 coincides with Acts chapter 15, that Jerusalem council. Okay. So, what's going on in the book of Acts? And we went through this a while back, the events of Acts for Israel. Okay, that's, well, maybe about a year already by now. Time flies, doesn't it? Yeah. But if you want, you go to TGBM 1000 and look for that message. It's there, okay? We went through this timeline. The events of Acts for Israel. But we're going to use a little bit of that today to remind us of what's going on in the book of Acts. So turn to Romans. Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11. Let's go to verse 5. It says, even so then, at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. When Paul's writing, he means, okay? So their election is according to grace, isn't it? And if by grace, then it is no more of works. He's talking about the election. Otherwise, grace is no more grace, but if it be of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. All that riddle is saying is that their election was by grace, okay? The little flock, and this is what we're going to look at here in verse 7. It says, what then? Israel had not obtained what he seeketh for, but the election had obtained it, and the rest were blinded. Okay, so during the book of Acts, there were some that were promised the kingdom, the members of the little flock, Luke chapter 12, verse 32, okay? That's who Paul's talking about here. Verse 8 says, according as it is written, God hath given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, ears that they should not hear unto this day. And David saith, let their table be made a snare and a trap and a stumbling block and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened that they may not see and bow down their back always. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation is come unto the Gentiles, for to provoke them to jealousy. Now, if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them be the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify mine office. For if by any means I may provoke to emulation them that which are of my flesh, fellow Jews, and might save some of them. Okay, so during the time period of the book of Acts, we have the little flock. Those that are members of the Jerusalem church, okay? Yes, kingdom saints, okay? Then, Paul says that, but the rest of them were blinded, okay? The rest of Israel were blinded. Let's keep that in mind. And then he goes on to say that they stumbled, they fell, and they did what? What does verse 12 say? Now if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them, of who? Israel. Correct? Okay. So, we see what's going on now in the book of Acts. We have two programs of God, two operations of God going on at the same time. We have that little flock, the kingdom, and then we know in Acts chapter 9, the calling out of Paul, we have the conception of the church, the body of Christ, and then the building of it thereafter. But for Israel, this is the key what we want to look at here. Israel stumbled at the cross, didn't they? 1 Corinthians 1:23 says that we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block. See, that's where Israel stumbled. Okay? At the cross. And it goes on to say about the fall of them. When did Israel fall? See, my wife just said to me the stoning of Stephen. That's it, okay? But this is where the confusion comes in. Well, Israel fell at the cross when they didn't receive him. Israel fell Pentecost. Israel fell Acts 28. Israel fell Acts 13, Acts 9. I mean, I'm confusing myself. There's so many times when everybody's preaching where Israel fell. But when did Israel fall? This is what we're going to look at today, okay? Because when we go back here and we look at this fall of Israel, when they fell, We will find out when Israel as a nation and these Jews became treated as heathen and became, I don't want to say members, okay, but they were identified with the uncircumcision. I thought Israel and the Jews were the circumcised. Believing Jews. Okay. Acts chapter 7. Verse 51. Remember, Israel stumbled at the cross. This is where they fell. And then from here on, they diminished away, didn't they? They diminished away. Acts 7, verse 51. Ye stiff-necked and what? Uncircumcised in heart and ears. Ye do always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do ye. This is where Israel fell. This is where they became recognized as the uncircumcised. Okay? So Israel stumbled at the cross. They fell here at the stoning of Stephen. And then throughout the book of Acts, they diminished away. And, I mean, we've looked at that numerous times. And I said this morning that when we can see some of these things, it seems so easy, doesn't it? When we have these things opened up to us and we want to accept them as truth, I think that's a big thing too, isn't it? Excuse me. Because some people just don't want to accept some of these things as being true because of the things they've been taught in the past. So, to me, yes, it may seem, oh man, look how simple it is. It's right here in front of you. But, you know, it's not always easy to see what's right in front of our eyes. Okay? We miss the simple things in life a lot of times because we try to look beyond what's right in front of us. So, this is where Israel fell. And this is where they become uncircumcised. In the heart. Okay? It's about the circumcision of the heart, isn't it? Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2, verse 28. It says, for he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit and not in the letter, whose praise is not of man, but of God. See, we see now back in Romans 11, when Paul's quoting Isaiah, that, you know, according as it is written, God had given them a spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, ears that they should not hear. Okay. When Paul writes this, he's talking about those unbelievers. The rest were blinded. They now become categorized into the uncircumcision, to the heathen. And that's what we see in Galatians chapter 2, in verse 9. It says that they were given the right hand of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they to the circumcision. Now, remember what I had said, okay? Throughout the book of Acts, Israel's diminishing away, aren't they? There's two operations of God going on at the same time. That little flock, they were promised the kingdom. They were still looking for it. How do I know that? go to Acts 26. And again, I know we looked at these verses before, okay? But repetition, repetition, repetition. Repetition is the mother of all learning. I'm sure you guys heard that phrase before. But now when we come in here, Acts 26, Paul in front of King Agrippa, okay? Let's just read it. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, thou art permitted to speak for thyself. Then Paul stretched forth the hand and answered for himself, I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because I shall answer for myself this day before thee, touching all things whereof I am accused of the Jews, especially because I know thee to be expert in all customs and questions which are among the Jews. Wherefore I beseech thee to hear me patiently. My manner of life from my youth was what at the first among mine own nation at Jerusalem know all the Jews. So what he's saying is all the Jews knew about Paul and his upbringing, okay? And then he talks about that in Philippians as well. Which knew me from the beginning, if they would testify that after the most straitest sect of our religion, I lived the Pharisee. And now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made of God unto our fathers, the kingdom, unto which promise are 12 tribes instantly serving God day and night, hope to come. So when Paul is in front of King Agrippa here in Acts 26, the 12 tribes, see, there's no lost tribes, okay? All 12 are there. They're waiting for this kingdom, aren't they? They're still waiting for the kingdom. And that's who James, Peter, and John are writing to. They're the circumcision. Are they the circumcision of the heart? Yes, they are. Okay, because when we're not going to look at it, but we did last week about when Peter calls them redeemed by the blood. They're born again. Okay. These folks are the circumcision that they're writing to. Now, remember, they're diminishing away, aren't they? Okay? They are diminishing away. Look at Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. Now, we're not going to get into the book of Hebrews today, but if you even go through and look at James, Peter, and John, okay, these folks, remember, there's two operations going on. What's next for them, if you would, on their timeline, is Jacob's trouble. See, they're looking for the kingdom, but they know before the Lord comes back, they know what Zechariah said, that the Lord's coming back to earth. They know what was said in Acts chapter 1, that this same Jesus that you see leaving is coming back the same way. He's coming back to earth. They knew that, but they also knew about Daniel's 70th week. They knew about Jacob's trouble. They knew of that 7-year period of tribulation. They knew that was coming next. And remember some of the things that James, Peter, and John writes about, especially in Peter. You know, when he talks about salvation taking so long. Okay? But the writer of Hebrews as well is writing to these folks in preparing them for that tribulation period because they know the kingdom's coming next. They're the circumcision. And that's what Hebrews talks about, the new covenant, you know, a better thing to come. But here in Acts chapter 8, and Saul was consenting unto his death, and at that time there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Remember, they hung out because they were waiting for that kingdom as well, and they were going to rule on the 12 thrones. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering to every house and hauling men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Now, look at Acts chapter 11. verse 19. Now they, which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that rose about Stephen, traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, preaching the word to none but unto the Jew, the Jews only. Okay? Now, this is these folks that were preaching to the Jews only, that were scattered abroad. I mean, the only word they had was Old Testament, right? And it was all about the kingdom, their coming Messiah. They had no truth of the revelation of the mystery that we preach today. And they were preaching to Jew only. 1 Peter. Again, we've looked at some of these verses. First of all, let's go to James first. It's in order. We'll just take them in order. Okay, we'll see the scattered ones that Peter's writing to in a second. But we see in the 12 tribes that we're waiting for the promise, the kingdom, right? And we know that right hand of fellowship that was made between James, Peter, and John, and Barnabas and Paul, that they would go to the circumcision, okay? And we would go to the heathen. When I say we, I mean Paul and Barnabas. But look who James writes to. Just briefly, okay, we're going to go through this a little quicker because we've done this many times. But for those that haven't seen it, James, a servant of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. Okay? Remember the 12 tribes. What are they waiting for? Go to James chapter 2, verse 8. Again, if we're all in the same church, the body of Christ together, one body truth, look what James says here. If ye fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love the neighbor as thyself, ye do well. But if ye have respect of persons, you commit sin and are convinced of the law as transgressors. For whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point is guilty of all. For he that said, do not commit adultery, said also, do not kill. Now thou commit no adultery, yet if thou kill, thou art become a transgressor of the what? Law. Are we under the law today in the church body of Christ? So how can James be writing to us? Why? Because he's writing to the circumcision who are still under the law. Acts 21:20, they are still zealous for the law, weren't they? Okay. Now, let's go in order. Let's go to 1 Peter. Verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. This is who Peter's writing to. Those same ones that are scattered abroad by the stoning, because of the stoning of Stephen, right? Same ones James is writing to. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, peculiar, that you should show forth the praises of him who had called you out of darkness unto his marvelous light. Are we a holy nation? Are you a holy nation? As it no. We don't have a priestly ministry. We looked at this, I think it was last week or the week before. That goes all the way back to Exodus 19. Okay? That God would make them a peculiar nation, a peculiar people, and a holy nation. And that they would become kingdom of what? Priest. Verse 10. Which in time past were not a people, but now are the people of God, which have not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust and war against the soul. Having your conversation honest among the Gentiles. Now, Peter's making a distinction here, isn't he? He says, have your lifestyle so that these Gentiles are going to see it, right? I thought there was no difference between Jew and Gentile in the church, the body of Christ. But Peter's saying something different here, isn't he? Okay, see, it just doesn't make sense, gang. It just doesn't make sense. We got to go to 1 Peter. Okay, because somebody will say, well, see that, you got them too, but Peter doesn't say anything about that kind of thing or put us under the law. But chapter 1 says that, you know, to keep the commandments. Excuse me? No, I'm sorry, did I say, well, I'm going to go to 1 John. Yeah, I said I got to show something from 1 John down here. I'm sorry. You know, chapter 3, again, there's no way these things can be for us. And we looked at other verses, you know, and even in chapter 2, if you know he is righteous, you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. And then when you come into chapter 3, look at verse 4. Whosoever committeth a sin transgresses also the law, for sin is a transgression of the law. That's the only verse I'm going to read. That should be enough, okay? See, because that right hand of fellowship that was made with James, Peter, and John, that they should go to the circumcision, those folks were still under the law. They were still waiting for the kingdom. That's who they're writing to, gang. Okay? That's who they're writing to. And during the time period of Acts, there were two operations of God going on at the same time. And then when you come into Acts chapter 28, maybe next week we'll look at those verses, but then it becomes official. He's going to all nations. Gentiles is all nations, by the way, folks, okay? It's not necessarily somebody that's not a Jew, but it's all nations. Now, let's go back to Galatians and look at the other part of that fellowship that was made. Okay? Now remember, Galatians chapter 2, verse 9. Remember the little makeshift definition, and I don't think I did it any harm or, you know, to the Webster or any definition, but the definition of a heathen is one that does not have a relationship with God. And that's what the Old Testament scriptures claim it as well. 142 times in the Old Testament, 3 times in what we dub the New Testament, okay? But here we see now in Galatians chapter 2, verse 9, and when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be fellows, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship, that we should go to the heathen, and they to the circumcision. So we just seen who the circumcision are, right? Excuse me. Remember, he who is a Jew is a Jew of the circumcision of the heart. And next week, we're going to look at Romans chapter 2, I believe it's verses 16 to the end of the chapter, and then we're going to look at Romans chapter 10, verses 1 to 10. Remember, this is a big thing when Paul says, you know, if you confess with the mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. We're going to show that that has no place for us today in the dispensation of grace. That Paul was talking about those Jews at that time. Okay, I got to pick up the pace. Now, verse 9. James, Peter, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace was given unto me. Unto me they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go to the heathen, and they to the circumcision. So, heathen. Who are the heathen? Okay. Now, remember we looked back there in Acts chapter 7, verse 51, where Israel had the uncircumcision of the heart and the ears. And I made the statement that that's when they became recognized as uncircumcision. They became part of the heathen, didn't they? Because they had no relationship with God. But then you had the little flock that did, and they diminished away. All right. So let's keep them things in mind. Remember, Israel had a great commission, didn't they?
Yeah.
Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Mark, go into all, or Matthew 28, go into all nations, okay, baptizing them. But now we see something different going on in Acts chapter 15, don't we? Didn't they have the handshake of fellowship?
Yeah.
Remember, that Great Commission stopped then too, didn't it? Mm-hmm. And when James, Peter, and John go to the circumcision, they're preparing them for tribulation. But the heathen now include the unbelieving Israel. Okay, it includes unbelieving Israel. We have to remember that. So they become part of the heathen. These unbelievers. The uncircumcised of the ears and the heart. Now, Galatians chapter 1. Verse 11. And I'm going to prove this, okay, that Israel are part of the heathen, and they are uncircumcised of the heart. For I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man, for I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. For ye have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited in the Jews' religion of many my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, for what reason? To reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, I immediately conferred not with flesh and blood. So Paul was to go to the heathen. Okay? Now, it's interesting. Galatians chapter 3, verse 8. Says, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen, what? Through faith or by faith? Through faith. Preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, In thee shall all nations be blessed. Okay, so, you know, God knew this, okay? Remember, things were kept secret since the world began, hid in the mind of God. But these heathen now, yes, it includes in time past, was anybody not part of that commonwealth of Israel, correct? And had no relationship with God. But now, Paul is going to the heathen. Israel, as a nation, are also considered heathen to God, as we've seen in Acts chapter 7, verse 51. And then we've seen the comparison in Romans chapter 11, didn't we? That this little flock, okay, they believed that the election received what God promised them, this kingdom, but the rest were blinded. And I hear somebody saying, well, okay, but how can you prove that Israel are part of the heathen? Let's go to Acts 13, and I think it'll come clear. I hope it comes clear. Okay. And I think this might open up and help with a lot of the confusion in the book of Acts. Because remember, after Paul started his ministry, where did Paul go first? He went to the Jew first. He went into the synagogues. Acts 13. And let's see. Verse 3. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, he sent them away. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed to Cilicia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. And when they were at Salamis, they preached the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, right? Now, jump over with me a little bit. And look at verse 14. It says, when they departed from Persia, they came to Antioch in Pisidia, and went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and sat down. Okay, I don't think anybody's going to disagree with me that Paul went to the synagogue first, right? No problema. But when Paul went into these synagogues, the first message he preached was what? The gospel of God. Why did he have to preach the gospel of God when he went to these synagogues? Because there were Jews in that synagogue that were uncircumcised of the ear and the heart. They were heathen in God's eyes. They were heathen. Remember what the gospel of God is, okay? Keep your finger here in Acts 13, but Romans chapter 1, okay? Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be a Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. So Paul went into these synagogues to prove to these uncircumcised heathen that this Jesus that you rejected is the Son of God. And then when we come in back into Acts chapter 13, from verse 14 all the way down to verse like 37, Paul preaches him the gospel of God, doesn't he? He does a history of Israel, and he talks about his resurrection. Then, in verse 38, Paul gives them the gospel of Christ. The heathen, Jew, the uncircumcised in the heart, in the ears. Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the what? Forgiveness of sins. That's not the same as remission. It is not the same. Forgiveness is for those in this dispensation of grace. He's preaching forgiveness of sin to these heathen Jews who are uncircumcised. And by him, all that believe are justified from all things which he could not be justified by the what? Law of Moses. Okay? So when Paul goes into these synagogues, he preaches to the Jew, yeah. They're part of the heathen, because that's what he was called to do. That's why he went into the synagogue first. That's why he went to the Jew first. Why? They were given the oracles of God. And that's what God told him to do. Okay? So Paul went to the synagogue, preached the gospel of God. He had to prove to these uncircumcised Jews, unsaved Jews, he preached the gospel of God, then he preached the gospel of Christ. And that was the pattern how Paul did it when he went into the synagogues. That's why he did it, okay? But now look at verse 43 in Acts 13. See, now when the congregation was broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes, folks, a religious proselyte is a Gentile, okay? They're members of the little flock. The religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, Paul and Barnabas was speaking to these Jews and religious proselytes, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. They weren't saved by the gospel of the grace of God. He just said, continue in the grace of God. God's grace was from the beginning of creation. God showed Adam grace. So let's not get confused when we hear this word grace. But he told these Jews and religious proselytes that make up the little flock, keep doing what you're doing. And that's what we read in Romans 11 when we started. In verse 5, even so then at this present time also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And if by grace, then it is no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it be of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. The election. What then? Israel hath not obtained what it seeketh for, but the election hath obtained it. The rest were blinded. The ones that were blinded were those uncircumcised, unbelieving Jews in the synagogues. that Paul preached to. They were heathen, because that's what Paul was told to do. He was separated to preach to the heathen. So Israel today, as a nation, okay, are heathen. They have no relationship with God. They're not, they're in circumcision. Israel is there in uncircumcision. So, real quick, that right hand of fellowship, when James, Peter, and John go to the circumcised, they're members of the little flock that are scattered. They're waiting for the kingdom. They're preparing for tribulation. They're circumcised of the what? Of the heart. They're redeemed. They're born again. They had the unction of the Holy Ghost. I also believe they had a taste of the new covenant. Okay? I think we talked about that before. And that's what 1 John talks about, okay? Especially when he says those that are born of God cannot sin. Why? Because they had the Holy Ghost in them. Okay? Then Paul and Barnabas go to the heathen, which include Jews, because they're uncircumcised of the heart and ear. Israel fell in Acts chapter 51. They became recognized as uncircumcision to God. They're heathen. Okay. I get excited. Okay? I hope, folks, that this helps. Okay? Take your time. Follow along what we said today. All right? Have questions? Call me. Email me. Facebook me. Write me a letter. Okay? Come visit me. Alright? But Israel today is there as a nation in uncircumcision. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time, and we pray you open hearts up to the truth of your word, and that it would clear things up about these false teachings about your word today. And we thank you in Christ's name.
Amen.